welcome to today's Focus KSA discussion. My name is Richard Wilson. I'm president of the Saudi-U.S. Trade Group. The Focus KSA series is produced by the Saudi-U.S. Trade Group and our partner, SUSTG.com. And we're delighted today to have Dr. Fahad al Turki. Dr. Fahad is head of research for Jadwa Investments. Jadwa is a well-known, highly regarded, Sharia-compliant investment group based in Riyadh, and has recently published a very interesting report on the opening to foreign investors, expanded opening to foreign investors that is anticipated now in 2015. Saudi-U.S. Trade Group and SUSTG relies a great deal on Jadwa's analyses and commentary. They do really great work, and their publications can be found at jadwa.com. Before we examine the opening of the stock market to a broader swath of foreign investment, perhaps Dr. Fahad can talk with us a little bit about the economic underpinnings of this decision and the extraordinary growth that Saudi Arabia has experienced over the last decade, particularly with the accelerating pace over the last 5 years. It's a very interesting story. The expansion is of great interest to not only U.S. investors, but globally. So, Dr. Fahad, with that, can you give us some background on both economic growth in Saudi Arabia as well as the impending broadening opportunities for foreign investment in the Saudi stock market?
Well, thank you, Richard, for your invitation, and thanks for the Saudi-U.S. Trade Group for the invite to present our view. As you mentioned, we have an extended number of reports that is listed in our website for anybody who's interested in having a lot of details and a lot of analysis on the Saudi economy. First, as you mentioned, the Saudi economy has been doing very well in the last 5 years, actually since the financial crisis. And before digging into the Saudi macro or the Saudi economy and going into the details and the drivers and everything, and going to the Saudi market and the openness of the Saudi market, I would like to highlight or put the Saudi economy in its global context. First, you know, Saudi Arabia is part of the G20, part of the largest 20 economies globally. It is currently around number 18 in the rank of the size of the GDP. Now, if you look at the performance of the Saudi economy in relative to the performance of the global economy over the last 5 years, or since the financial crisis, actually, you will see an outstanding performance as judged by the macroeconomic numbers. So things are going well since the financial crisis. The average growth in Saudi economy has been around 6% per annum on average. There has been a huge, a tremendous reserves accumulation over the years because of the surplus in the external account. The surplus has been around in double digits since the financial crisis, and this is mainly because of the favorable oil prices that has been above $100 for the last 3 years. So if you compare that to global, to the G20 peers, as well as other emerging economies, you will find one thing: that growth rate in Saudi Arabia has been on the upside. And also, if you compare the interest rate in Saudi Arabia, so the official interest rate, the repo, is around 2%, which is on the low side. So you can think of the Saudi economy as being also stimulated by the monetary policy. If you compare the fiscal account, Saudi Arabia has been able to record double-digit surplus as a percent of its GDP, which is on the high side. So all these economic or macro indicators point to a very strong macro picture in the Saudi economy. Now, if we go down to the sensitivity of the Saudi economy to the global economy, to the global development, we find that Saudi economy used to be a little bit sensitive to changes in the global oil market in particular. Actually, the oil market is the only or the main channel of which international development can affect the Saudi or the domestic development. But that is not true in the last, actually, 5 years. Yes, the support, the accumulation of reserves is because of higher oil revenue, but the sensitivity of Saudi economy to oil prices has been weakened over the last, actually, 5 years because of Saudi Arabia was able to accumulate more than 100% of its GDP in term, as a reserves asset, and also drive down the debt to GDP to around 0% in international standard. So these are main important cushions that protect the domestic economy or domestic economic fundamentals from international development or international unfavorable development, to be exact. The other thing that I want to shift to, Richard, is what you mentioned in terms of the oil and in terms of the drivers for the domestic economy. I think when we look at the Saudi economy, we think that most of the drive for the Saudi economy is government spending. Government spending on both sides, the government current side spending, and as well as investment spending. On this, on the current spending, we've seen a lot of increase, which is on average 10% rise on annual basis for the last 10 years. And this helped many of the sectors in the Saudi economy, which we will come to talk about. But also on the other side, the government investment spending has been growing at an average of around 20% per annum for the last 10 years. I don't think there are many countries that can accumulate that growth for an extended period of time, which has been an important driver for many of the sectors in the kingdom. The other part of the economic driving force behind this strong growth in Saudi Arabia is the availability of credit and the liquidity in the banking sector. There is a lot of liquidity in the banking sector, which, as with a low interest rate, has pushed lending rate to a level that is consistent with the strong growth, which also helped us with the private sector to grow on a very respectable number of around 5 to 6% over the last few years. And also there's another driver, which is the consumption spending or consumption by domestic consumers. There's a lot of demand given the increase or the large increase in domestic income. There have been a lot of consumption spending, and that consumption spending also benefits many of the retail sector, health sector, education sector, and the other sectors of the Saudi economy.
Fahad, thank you. That's a very useful overview, and it leads to two questions. Well, more than that, but right off the bat, it is extraordinary the pace of government spending over the last decade. As you point out, I don't know of anybody else, any other country that can claim to have had increased government spending of 20% over a 10-year period. This has been certainly a very important countercyclical impetus when there's a global downturn and or even when there's unrest in the region after 2011. The ultimately, the government wants to back off on being the primary engine of growth and have the private sector and shoulder more of that burden. Where do you see the fiscal planners and the government? Where do you see them in their vision of this? How do you see the growth in government spending declining in coming years?
I think there's I mean when we talk about government spending, it doesn't come as a free of risk. So there are a number of risks that need to be highlighted. So 20%. Increase per annum over the last 10 years for the capital spending is a little bit overheating some of the sectors, and I can talk about some of the sectors that reached a little a level of of a capacity constraint, and in that regard, talk about construction sector reaching a capacity constraint. At some point in the kingdom, in this process, there has been a shortage of construction material that meets the need or the demand for the construction activities that is going on in the kingdom. So there are expenses for this such strong growth, but I think most of this spending is going or directed toward building an infrastructure that ultimately will develop or push the private sector to develop and benefit from such investment. And in that regard as well, if you look at the contribution of the private sector to overall GDP, it has been growing over time. The growth of the private sector over the last 3 years has been the major driver the major contributor to over, not the driver, the contributor to economic growth, to the overall economic growth. And the reason for this is because oil sector on the other side, if you think of the Saudi economy, it's either the oil sector or the non-oil. The oil sector has been volatile. The volatility of it is because of other factors related to global production, oil production, or global demand, or geopolitical developments in the region or globally. So that has been volatile a little bit over the last few years. But on the private sector in the kingdom, there has been a steady increase in government spending that feeds the private sector growth and development over the last few years, which we've seen as a number in terms of the contribution of the private sector to overall GDP growth is growing over time as well.
You had identified three drivers: the government spending, the bank liquidity, and also domestic consumption. Let me ask two questions about the bank liquidity. Yes, tremendous amounts of money available for investment. But one of the great issues for Saudi Arabia is job creation, and so often the greatest job creators are small and medium-sized enterprises. Now, many reports, many studies that indicate that some of these smaller enterprises actually are having difficulty getting access to funding and support, especially entrepreneurs. In other words, the banks have so many opportunities at large-scale levels. This smaller SME sector is underserved. Is that an issue that you see and is being addressed?
Yeah. Well, there are also not only it's not only the banks that provide credit to SMEs in Saudi Arabia. So probably there is difficulty for SMEs to access bank credit. But what the government has been doing over the last actually 20 years is going creating these specialized credit institutions that were offering a credit on a less of more of an ease conditions on the SMEs to participate and to grow their businesses. Specialized credit institutions, there are a number of them, five in Saudi Arabia. They were established back in the 80s that contributed a lot to the development of the private sector over the last years. And now there is more need for credit for SMEs, and there are a number of programs by the Ministry of Commerce that looks into developing SMEs and providing not only credit but also consultation. In terms of labor, creating job opportunities for the local market, I think Saudi Arabia has been one of the most open labor markets in the world for cheap labor over the last 20 years. It's not until 2011 when Saudi Arabia started to regulate the labor market, started to look into the private sector as a partner to employ the Saudi nationals rather than importation of labor, of cheap labor from outside the kingdom. And I think this is a process that is ongoing. I think we have seen a number of results of it. There has been a number of increase in Saudi working force in the private sector over the last year and a half.